So good evening. I am Mrs. Chulson. I'm one of the counselors here at Chattahoochee High School. I'm very excited to be able to present this information to you at home. I actually had my son's curriculum night for fifth grade last night from home while I made dinner. So I hope that you can sit back, relax, get some information tonight and not be so stressed with the parking lot and trying to race here and get a seat and, you know, do it our old school way. I do want everybody to stay safe and healthy. I know that this is a very unconventional start to the year. We have never started a year like this in all of my years in education. And it is something that we're just going to have to roll with. But there are some perks, like not having to find parking. We really do miss seeing everyone. We miss having kids in the hall and all the student questions and all of that. But we are proud of very much of your patience, of your resilience, of your sticking to it as we get started. And you made it to your senior year, so students out there watching, I am super proud of you. I know all the counselors, I'm speaking on behalf of them, and I say we're really proud. You've endured a lot in the last 6 to 8 months, and I know this isn't the way you wanted to start your senior year, but here we are, and we're going to do it, and we're going to do it well. So let's just kick it off. Oh, and just so you know, Ms. Blunt is also my other co-presenter, and she is going to answer questions to everybody at the end. And there is a way for you to ask questions, so we are going to we are going to give you some virtual meeting hints so that you can make it through this presentation and get the information that you need for your student and or for the senior watching. I appreciate you logging in. We have over 400 people in attendance. Right now we have 413 people. This presentation does allow for Q&A. There is a meeting chat option, live event Q&A on the right hand of your screen. I've kind of highlighted at the bottom where you can put your name or you can check off the thing that you want to be anonymous. That's totally fine. And you can ask your question and click the little arrow at the bottom. I'm going to kind of circle it with my cursor. And you can see how to ask questions. I encourage you to ask questions as we go. You're welcome to do that. If we do not get to your question in that moment, please know that we are going to also address questions at the end. And Ms. Blunt is going to be the one answering questions in the chat, so I can focus on the presentation. Okay, some other helpful hints. This presentation does allow for people at home that speak a different language or need to have the information presented to them in a different language. At the very bottom of your chat, there should be a little gear ball that looks like this. And that's for subtitles that you can put. And we have different languages that you can choose from. Everything from Chinese, Korean, Russian, Spanish, Vietnamese to help you translate the presentation if that's an easier method for your family. Okay, so here in the counseling department, I know most of you know this by now, but we do have some seniors that are new to us this year. So counselor name, I have all last names A through DAQ, and Ms. Johnson has all last names D-A-R through H-E-L. Ms. Murray has H-E-M through M-A-R. Ms. Blunt has M-A-S through S-A-H. And then Ms. Jones has S-A-I through Z. We have a lot of support staff in our office. This year, I will highlight that the caseloads are somewhat adjusted. The school counseling assignments were adjusted to really serve our students and our families more effectively. So be sure that when you're communicating with your child's counselor, the appropriate counselor for this school year, so that we can make sure we're, you know, keeping in touch with you and know what your needs are. We also have other support staff, like I said. We have graduation coaches in our office, a 504 chair, our school social worker, who's amazing, Ms. McClung, and our parent liaisons, Ms. Butler, works our front office, answering the phones and really doing all of the stuff in the trenches that we appreciate so much. We do have a counselor Bitmoji that we created. It's on our website. You can make an appointment to see a counselor, or really just about anybody in our office, you can make an appointment to see them. If you go to the counseling webpage and go on the spot where it says meet your counseling staff, which is over here on this side, there's a little part where it says meet your counseling staff. You can click on that and you will get to this screen. You click on the person that you need to make an appointment with. So here I am, I'm Mrs. Chilson. I really don't ever wear a blazer or any, I don't think my Bitmoji looks like me at all. But in any case, you can make an appointment with me. And while we're in the appointment, you can tell me what I need to do differently with my looks here. But all of us have a little appointment link. So Ms. Johnson's down here, Ms. Vermurray, Ms. Butler, everybody. The one person missing off this Bitmoji is our new parent liaison for our Spanish speakers, and that is Ms. Andujar. She is not listed on here, but she is on our website. She just joined us probably like maybe a week ago. So we're thrilled that she's here, but know that we have an addition. Oh, whoops. Went too far. Okay, so here's the Stay Connected at the Hooch. The biggest thing for this year is that we have a class of 2021 senior page for each counselor created a Teams portal. So just like you have a Teams for your, you know, each of your classes, we created a team for the seniors, but it's by counselor. So every time I want to post an announcement to the students, they can go on their Microsoft Teams account, see their class of 2021 page, and see announcements. I've posted all kinds of stuff. I mean, you know, not just about this meeting, but about other important topics. They cannot make comments in that spot, but I do love when they post their little heart emoji, or they got the message, or they under, you know, they can do a little emoji in the corner of the message to let me know they got it. Like today for the message, I said, give me a thumbs up if you're going to attend the meeting tonight. And I got some thumbs up. That makes me happy when I see those. This really takes the place of the Remind app for us, or Google Classroom. We don't have access to that anymore, so we had to come up with a new way of doing things. But if they need anything where they actually need a reply and they need to post something, they need to just email us. So email will be the best way. We're also on Facebook. We have a Facebook page for Chattahoochee, and there's actually a counseling Facebook page as well. There's a Twitter page, there's the main website, and then of course there's the counseling website. One of the big things that you're gonna need to know is that Infinite Campus is the biggest, most important place that you're gonna see attendance, grades, transcripts that you can view. So down at the bottom, most everything that you see in this PowerPoint, which will be posted tomorrow, is clickable. So you can click straight to, if you don't have an Infinite Campus portal and you need to get one, you can click on that and it will take you to the steps on how to get your portal set up for your parent portal. Okay, so let's talk about graduation requirements. Most of y'all know these already, but I know we have, again, new students, and I want to make sure everybody is aware that this 23 total credits that you have to graduate are very specific credits. It's not just any English or any science or any social studies. Like, we have a lot of kids that take AP Human Geography. That's fantastic, but that is not one of the three credits that's required. That can count towards electives. Or AP Psychology. Great, I'm glad you took that class. A lot of kids love AP Psych. We love that. But that is not one of the three required social studies. So it is very important that your child is meeting the specific credits that are necessary to graduate. You cannot earn your diploma. You cannot walk at graduation. You cannot be a part of the ceremony in any shape or form if you have not specifically earned those 23 credits by graduation day. So it's important that you have that. If you think that you're missing anything, if you think that you didn't do that personal fitness credit or that health credit that is required, you know, those kinds of things, then you really need to be emailing your counselor to have that conversation, because you know, we don't want to miss anything, and y'all certainly don't want to miss anything either. So it takes all of us as a team to make sure that everybody's on track for graduation. And we had meetings at junior meetings. This is another follow-up to that conversation. One of the things that we always discuss is this part down here, that world language. World language is not a graduation requirement. It absolutely is not something that you have to graduate in Fulton County. However, if you want options for after high school, if you wanted to be able to attend that four-year college, most, almost all four-year colleges require the 2 years of a language. So it's okay if you don't have it, you can graduate it without it, and that is totally fine. The part up here where it says world language or fine art or career tech class, that's 3 credits. It can be a mix and match. So you could have had an art like ceramics, you could have a marketing class, and you could have done Spanish 1, and you have met that requirement. So, you know, just know that this is one of the things that we try to reinforce since 9th grade year of what you have to graduate. The other thing that has changed is that we have this electronic personal fitness waiver. This is clickable, and it's important because you have, if you assume that you're going to get that waiver, you don't get it unless you've submitted the paperwork. So it's very important that you do it. This year, it's electronic. It just goes straight to our data clerk, and either Coach Hicks or Mr. Garofalo sign off on it. So it just makes the process that much smoother. It does require a student to have completed 1 season of a GHSA sport or 1 season of marching band. So if you were playing lacrosse and you got a concussion and you didn't finish the season, then that technically does not count to receive the waiver. So you have to do a whole season. So just know that it's something you want to keep up with. If you haven't submitted it yet, you really should do so as soon as possible. I think most of my kiddos have done that. Okay, let's stay here. Okay, so let's talk about some post-secondary options. A lot of students are really thinking through the option of a gap year, and for a lot of various reasons. Most students do this because they're really unsure of what their major might be in college, or maybe they need an experience that will help them figure out their path. But also right now with COVID, I think that a lot of students are second guessing maybe paying a huge bill to go out of state for college and actually having to do it virtually from home. So there are a lot of options for taking a gap year. I've added in some links here, the Peace Corps, AmeriCorps program. There's all kinds of different service organizations and mission groups and ways to volunteer. But if you're looking for a different experience, then, you know, those are some things that are opportunities out there. Of course, there's always the option to work, to take a year and go to work. If you're, especially if you're not really sure where you're headed or what you want to do, or maybe life right now is a little complicated and your family needs help with paying bills, or and they just want another person to help with those kinds of tasks, then you consider a gap year. It doesn't hurt anything. I don't know if it left me. I'm hoping y'all can still hear me. I can't really tell if I am getting you guys or not. I don't know if it cut out on me. I think it cut out on me for a second, so just want to make sure everybody can hear and see me, or not even see me, just see the PowerPoint. But basically, there's a lot of options for after high school, and gap year and working and volunteering is one of those options. There's employment opportunities, a lot of great apprenticeship options. I put some things from the Department of Labor. The Technical College System of Georgia Schools also do apprenticeship programs where you can, like we had I had a student last year that is doing apprenticeship for being an electrician this year. He's already on the job working, training, doing that program so that he can be an electrician. So it's an awesome way to start a career path. There also is the option of joining the military. There are wonderful options for military recruiting services in the Johns Creek area. These are all the clickable links for the Air Force, Army, and so forth, the National Guard. So I hope that students will take advantage of the option that best suits them. There is no one size that fits all students. It is every student needs to do what is best for them and for their family. I highly encourage you to talk to your parents about what options are on the table and what would be a best fit. I certainly, don't want somebody to take something on that they're not ready or prepared for. And that includes military, that includes college, that includes going to volunteer on the other side of the world. So please talk to your parents about all the options and, you know, make sure that you're doing what's in your best interest. Okay, so just like with after high school, there are so many options and everybody needs to do their own thing. I also want to ensure that every college admissions process is very different. Every college admissions process does their own qualifications to get in. There is a no one size fits all admissions process. There is a great organization out there called the National Association for College Admission Counseling, and they issue out every year a state of the college admissions, and they usually give factors that are the most considered factors for college admissions. Some of them are the GPA, the grades, your academic courses. That is probably the most important part that they look at in the admissions process is your transcript. They look at that rigor of courses, the strength of the curriculum, your test scores, which I'll talk about in a second, and your personal qualities, things that you might be involved in, things you're passionate about, things you have interest in. So all of those things are important. If you want to read through the entire report, it's a lengthy one, but pages 14 and 15 are probably, I think, one of the more important pages in the article. It's just very detailed report from NACAC, which is the overseeing organization for admissions for all colleges pretty much around the United States. Going back to test scores, I've sat in on a lot of webinars this year, specifically this week, so many schools are going test optional. If you have a score and you want to send it, that's totally fine, but I want to make clear that no one is going to be disadvantaged if they choose not to send their scores. If that college is saying they're test optional, and most colleges have said that, some may not be saying that, you really have to check the individual websites, but if they are test optional and they're saying that, they really are saying that you're not going to be disadvantaged if you choose not to send your scores. You may be asked to submit different supplemental items, like, for example, University of South Carolina. I was on a call with them and they specifically said that you have to choose one of the three options. If you're not going to submit your test scores, then you could submit some AP scores. You could submit an essay from high school that was graded. So they're looking for additional information to be able to, make determinations and determine their best fit for their incoming freshman class. If you are unsure about what's required or what the process is going to look like, I encourage you to please meet with the college representative. Go on the college website for information. Almost all the college websites I have been on, I've been able to get information. Okay, some colleges use a holistic perspective. This is probably more going to be the case this year than any other year. A lot of schools have used this process pretty thoroughly in the past. It's not a new thing for them. More colleges are using it this year, but when it comes to really highly selective schools, they've typically placed less emphasis on test scores. And so not using them this year isn't really that different. I was on a call with Yale, Princeton, UVA, Harvard, and Wellesley, and all of them were saying, you know, this is the process we've pretty much stuck to. So just because we don't have test scores this year, that was such a small percentage of their what they looked at. So I would not be fearful not to send a test score to a college, but if you felt like your test scores would add value to the application, then absolutely send it. It's a personal decision. Everybody has to make it a decision on their own. When it comes to a holistic perspective, that's when it comes to, you know, your application essay, your actual application, the letters of recommendation, your leadership stuff, your demonstrated interest, all those kinds of things. Some of the schools specifically said they're not even looking at subject tests. So it just really depends on the school. Every school is going to be a little bit different this year about how they're going to evaluate admissions standards and whether or not they're going to admit a student. Okay, let's talk about GPA. So grade point average. Students should always use the actual numeric average that is on their high school transcript when they're applying to colleges. So you'll go onto the college application and they are going to ask you specifically what your high school GPA is. You do not convert your GPA to the 4.0 scale for the college. You are supposed to take that exact average that is on your high school transcript and put it in the college application. And then they're going to say, what scale is this on? Well, we are on a 100-point scale. That's the way Fulton County does grade point average. We use the weighted average. That's what you should be reporting. You report what's on your transcript. So for example, if your GPA on your transcript is an 87.9, that is the average that you're going to put on your transcript on your college application. The other thing is the high school GPA used for college admission is calculated by the post-secondary institution. It is not calculated by us or by Fulton County or anything like that. They're going to take that GPA that we submit on your transcript and they will recalculate it the way that they see fit for the institution and their admissions process. Every college could possibly calculate things a little bit differently. Most colleges do some sort of a conversion to the 4.0 scale, but they tend to only include your academic or your core courses. Whether or not they'll leave those 7 points in or take them out, that is up to the college. I tend to think that the majority of colleges leave those 7 points into your core courses and then recalculate, but every college again is different. If you want to know how that college is going to calculate GPA, you need to ask the college rep. Okay, so those are very specific questions for an individual college. Or just be confident in how you've performed and let it go because I'm sure everyone has, you know, done their best. And there's always a place on a college application for you to explain any circumstances or things about high school that were difficult for you or that kind of thing. Okay, talking about honor cords and the start of Hope GPA stuff. So every year, students would like to know whether or not they earned an honor cord. And that's for graduation. There's certain cords that you get, like a double gold cord or a blue and gold or a double white. And it's all based on what's on your transcript at the end of first semester. It does not go till the end of the year. So please know that whatever your GPA says on your transcript at the end of first semester, that is the GPA that will be used for determination of honor cords. You have to have a 96 or higher for summa, a 92 or higher for magna, and an 88 or higher for cum laude. We do not round up at all for honor cords. Your GPA does not get rounded. So if you have an 87.99999, you will not earn that cum laude designation at graduation on your honor cord. So just know that it's important to work as hard as you can to get what you want to get as much as you can. And then, you know, as I said a minute ago, gotta be happy with where you're at, because there's no changing it at that point. Preliminary HOPE GPAs, a lot of students always want to know what their GPA is for HOPE, because when it comes to GPA, there's a lot of ways to slice the data. There's a HOPE GPA, there is the college GPA as to how a college is going to make determinations, and then there's your high school transcript GPA. So just know that there, you know, your preliminary HOPE GPA, you can see it on Georgia Futures around mid-September. If you haven't given us a copy of your Social Security card, unfortunately, that is one of the things that you absolutely have to provide in order to be HOPE eligible. We have to upload that information into the Georgia Student Finance Commission portal in order to then for you to have access to your HOPE GPA. So let's talk a little bit further about HOPE GPA. The biggest thing is that you have to have a 3.0 core average. So it doesn't really include electives for the most part. There are some electives that count, but they're very few and far between. You do have to have at least 4 credits that are considered rigor. This is a clickable list in the PowerPoint all about what rigor is considered. Rigor for HOPE is very different than rigor for getting into Yale. So you have to have at least 4 credits that are considered rigor. A very big misconception is that you have to have an AP class. You do not have to have an AP class in order to get HOPE scholarship. HOPE scholarship pays, you know, a certain portion of the tuition for in-state public colleges. It will also pay a flat rate for a private school, but you know, it's just a little bit of money. All of the information is on this site about Georgia Futures, and you can click right here specifically about the HOPE scholarship stuff. But some of the key points when it comes to that rigor list is that, for example, if a student took Algebra 2 and they took AMDM or pre-calc, and they took chemistry or physics, and they took, you know, a Spanish 2, then they have met their rigor requirements. So the majority of students in Chattahoochee, the majority, not everybody, but the majority, just by default of being in our program, have pretty much completed the 4 credits. So, you know, you do need to look at yours to make sure that you have met that rigor component. And we, you know, if you're worried about it, you can reach out to your counselor and make that appointment. HOPE does not look at middle school grades that counted for high school credit that is excluded from the GPA. The weight is totally recalculated, so those 7 points are removed for honors, AP, and dual enrollment classes. And if a student took an AP or dual enrollment class, then a 0.5 weight is given for the course, but nothing extra is added on. So if a student got an A in a dual enrollment class without that 7 points, then the max GPA that they could have for the quality points would be 4.0. HOPE GPA cannot go over 4.0. So just take a look at that on the Georgia Futures site if you would like more information. Speaking of Zell Miller, the biggest difference is that it's all of the stuff from HOPE GPA, all of the above for HOPE GPA, but it's also, you have to have a core GPA, so academic classes only, of a 3.7 or higher. They also require test scores. Now, I know that with the test scores this year, they have not made any determinations about taking that out. That is written into law. And so unless they change the law, test scores are still going to be required. And so if that's reason enough for you to try and find a testing site, if that makes sense for you, then y'all can look into the information on signing up for an SAT or ACT. You have to have a minimum composite of a 26 on the ACT or a 1200 on one administration of the SAT. And the biggest thing is that for both of the HOPE and Zell, you do have to, for Zell Miller, you've got to send in your test scores, and you have to do that on your own. If you're going to be the valedictorian or a salutatorian, you automatically qualify for, and you meet the HOPE eligibility, you automatically require, are eligible for the Zell Miller, but You know, we only have one val and one sal every year. So the only other way to get it is with the 3.7, the test scores and meeting the rigor requirement and so forth. And you do have to apply for these. So you can apply on the Georgia Futures website, or you just submit the FAFSA. But there is an application for HOPE and for Zelle that you do have to complete before graduation. There's also a thing called the HOPE and Zelle Miller Grant. These are for certificate or diploma programs only, and it's specifically for technical colleges, which is fantastic. You didn't have to have a certain GPA out of high school in order to get these grants. So it's a fantastic opportunity. I posted some information in this link down here for how you can access that information. But the HOPE grant pays a portion and the Zelle Miller pays 100%. And this is for technical colleges of Georgia. There are just a couple of USG institutions, but they're pretty much in South Georgia, but it's just another opportunity. So senior year, what should you be doing? We talked junior year about what you should be doing, so this is just kind of a follow-up conversation, but all students should be investigating their options for after high school. You need to be narrowing down your list. If you haven't taken at least one SAT or ACT and you feel like you should, it's a personal decision. Maybe you need it for scholarships. Maybe you need it for a certain application to a college. But like I said, this year for the class, for y'all's class, most of the universities that I have seen are test optional. So if you can't get in to take a test and it's stressing you out or you're just worried about getting sick, I would strongly encourage you not to take the test if it's that big of a concern for you. Because all the colleges we've talked to said you would not be disadvantaged. But definitely begin working on applications, creating a timeline. One of the biggest things you can do for yourself your senior year is actually be very organized and diligent in creating your kind of your, you know, your timeline. Write down your dates and your deadlines. The deadlines for an application may be different than a deadline for a scholarship for that same college. So you want to make sure you're organized. There is still time, and I don't want anybody panicking. We just entered September, but researching colleges, you can definitely utilize the Naviance portal that I'm going to show you. You can schedule visits with college reps. You can do research on websites. You might want to consider some of the two-year colleges as a way to save money and get the exact same credits. There's a lot of opportunities for students. In Georgia, Georgia is a fantastic state to be in for colleges. There's so many opportunities. If you wanted to sign up for a standardized test, you can certainly do that. And you can start searching for scholarships. Okay, so college visits. We have reps that typically come to the college. They would come in our college and career center and give information to prospective students. This year, however, almost all the colleges, really all the colleges so far, have said they are going to do virtual visits. Students can register for a maximum of 7 on-campus visits per school year. So you do have to email your teacher to receive permission to miss class. So check and see what the time is. If it's during your lunch period, then it really you don't need to, you know, email anybody, or if it's during chat time, you might need to email your chat time teacher. But students should research some colleges prior to the visits, come prepared with questions for the rep. You should have some questions that you want to ask them. The college visit dates are posted on the Naviance portal, which I'm going to show you how to find the college visits and how to register for those in just a moment. And then there's the off-campus college visits. Off-campus visits are going to take the whole day. And you're going to check in there. The students are allowed six degree absences from school. A lot of them are doing the whole virtual situation at home. All you need to do is send an official note from the college on college letterhead to the attendance office to get it marked excused. Once we go back face-to-face, there is a specific pre-approved absence form that you have to pick up in the attendance office and get turned in prior to the visit. NACAC, that association I was telling you about just a little bit ago, they also do a virtual college fair. And if you click on that link, there's some fair tips and all the dates. But basically, September 13th, October 12th, the 18th, and November 8th, more than 600 colleges will be at each fair. So if you go back to that previous slide where maybe you haven't done any research, you're not sure where to begin, you don't know what to do first, college fairs are a great way to get a lot of information in a short amount of time. This is the directions. If you want to take a picture of this slide, you can certainly get out your phone, but it's how to register for a college visit, and I'm going to show you how to do it in a minute, but you're going to log into ClassLink, you choose the Naviance app, and there's a menu bar all about college visits. The SAT and ACT, these are the websites to sign up for tests. You do need to, if you really want to take it, you probably need to look now for dates because so many students are trying to get into tests. I don't know what's still available in our area, but collegeboard.org or ACT.org, those are the two sites. Students should follow these testing agencies for all COVID-19 updates, including test cancellation and refunds. Really, all of that stuff about cancellation and when am I getting money back, all of that stuff. So far, I think I've been spending money, but specific to these tests are really going to you need to get your information from them. That's the pay them to take it. And then test prep. There's information on the Chattahoochee website, at this website address, on how to get your test prep, and then sending the scores. Students are always like, oh, you need my test scores. I don't know about that, so there's the test scores, and I can't send the college alone, I don't know if you can. But you have to go onto your role where you registered, and then you have had to decide to send their scores. When you register, you're allowed to send them any scores for free. I don't recommend doing that because you can save money. So if you go ahead and send them, and it's okay, because the whole test optional thing, you would click on your application and don't want them to see your scores. And they would not utilize them. So just know that that's something that you can choose to do, so you don't have to pay additional money after you get your scores, and you make like $13 or $12 instead of $12. We also offer college application waivers. So if you're a student in need who may be served through the free or reduced lunch program or whatever reasons in your family struggling right now, and cannot afford the fees without applications, the school counselors have the ability to do a waiver. And it's really on a case-by-case basis. If you don't qualify, well, really, you have to qualify for the free and reduced lunch. So if you don't, but maybe fall in another category, like your income is low level or something like that, you can talk and see about getting a waiver. You can also reach out to the Butler in our process. She would be able to assist as well. One of the things too about the waivers is if you are applying to a Common App school, you just check off that you would like to have the waiver. If there's any question about whether or not you qualify, your school counselor is going to reach out to you. If it's not a Common App school, we have different waivers. College-bound athletes. If you're an athlete, you're looking to play a sport in college, and you have that wonderful talent, then there's certain processes that you have to go through. Prospective student athletes should do their registration at the NCAA Clearinghouse. And then Ms. Lang, the principal secretary, is the one that handles all the parent release forms and requesting transcripts for not for college admissions, specifically for athletes. So she's the one that would handle sending your transcript to the sports department or the athletic director or whoever needed it, NCAA. So you have to request it through her. So she uploads them to NCAA, so athletes and coaches have access to that portal. When you're taking the SAT or ACT, you're gonna enter the 999 four nines for scores to be sent to NCAA Clearinghouse. And you should always review the requirements because they may be different than grad requirements. And you can always ask questions to Coach Hicks. He's our athletic director. He knows the ins and outs of just recruitment and all of that for athletes way more than the counselors do. I'm going to talk briefly about scholarships. There's four main ways to look for scholarships. There's your institutional scholarships that are specific to colleges. There's your local scholarships that might be stuff just in our area in Johns Creek, like the American Legion or local banks or church groups or that kind of thing. There's national scholarships such as QuestBridge or the Hispanic Scholarship Fund offers a lot of scholarships, but they're national. So, you know, you have a lot of people that may qualify for a, you know, are trying to qualify for just a few spots. Then there's this thing called the academic common market. A lot of students sometimes are interested in that opportunity. It basically allows you to pursue an out-of-state degree at an in-state tuition rate, but there are very specific rules and policies to that, and all of the information, if you want to go there, is through this link right here. And you can use the scholarship link on the Naviance portal to research and explore options as well. Financial aid. The portal for financial aid for the FAFSA, which is the free application for federal student aid, opens October 1st every year. So you're welcome to start that process after October 1st. I know that Ms. Jones is planning to have a financial aid night. We're hoping to have it in early October. We're waiting on confirmation. But, you know, this is kind of a guide for you to kind of get started. There's always a net price calculator that you can use on each college page. I strongly recommend using the net price calculator if you want to see what the total cost of tuition might look like. It's very helpful. You should always know your deadlines for financial aid, for scholarships. There's always like a priority deadline. Sometimes it's as early as December 1st for colleges. So you want to look at those things now and make your list so you know kind of what you're looking at. There's a link here that I put at the very bottom that says what to do after I apply for FAFSA, and it will take you to a site through the U.S. Department of Education that kind of outlines some steps to what to do after you've applied so that you can get started on all of that. These are just suggestions on how to begin the FAFSA process. Always remember that if you type in FAFSA into Google and you just go with whatever it says, you should never be asked to pay any money to apply for a scholarship. You should never be asked any money to apply for FAFSA. Again, it's the free application for federal student aid, and it does not cost a penny to do that application. Okay, so now we're going to get rolling into the college application process. And there's a lot of different types of admissions options. There's everything from regular decision and a rolling admission and even early action, and all of them are non-binding. So you're not making any kind of formal commitment to the college. You're not restricted from applying to other institutions. You can consider all the options for enrollment. A lot of students get early action and early decision confused. Early action, again, is non-binding, but if you're choosing to apply early decision to a school, you're saying that it is your first choice of an institution, and if you get admitted, you're definitely going to enroll. You're committing. It's a binding application. As soon as you say you submit that early decision application and you sign off on the dotted lines agreeing that it's a binding, and then later you get in, you are expected to withdraw all other applications. So please know that there's a big difference between early decision and early action. The other thing is the restrictive early action. It is written out here. It's very similar to ED, but it is non-binding. I have seen very few schools that offer this option. Usually it's early decision or early action. I can't even think of a school that really offers the early restrictive early action off the top of my head. Okay, so this is a slide that I do encourage you to take a picture of. I do because these are questions that are asked on every college application, so you should just have this information at the ready. And that would include how many students are in your senior class. That would be 518. We do not report rank, percentile, or decile to students, parents, or colleges. That is something, as long as I've been at Chattahoochee, we have not done that. That is not something we are doing. We don't report rank. The only people that do get ranked are the valedictorian and the salutatorian, and that's only after we have first semester grades. So nobody really knows exactly where they stand. Hopefully that encourages students to just do your personal best and don't worry about what other people are doing. Your numeric average is weighted and it's on a 100-point scale. So I talked about that earlier. We offer 19 honors courses and 29 AP classes as well. So that's something that I want to make sure you understand, that these are things that sometimes come up on application that you have to fill in, and you should just have it. You should just know that information. So how do you apply to a college? Well, anytime you apply to a college, there's lots of different parts that go into a file at the college. In the old days, it probably was an actual manila file, just like this one. But these days, it's more virtual file. And you are going to have your application up here. You're going to pay your application fee, or you're going to provide the fee waiver. You're going to provide a copy of your transcript. You're going to provide the teacher recommendation, or your teacher is going to provide that form for you, but you have to request it. The counselor recommendation or the school report if it's required, and possibly test scores. There may be additional things that are not outlined here that go into your application file, such as a portfolio, an audition, an interview, all kinds of different things that certain schools may request. Essays, all kinds of supplemental materials. So just know that that is something that you know, just want to make sure you have it all kind of together. Okay, so who does what? So students choose options from the institution about how to apply. So a college might have a various way of doing their application. Let me go back a second. I forgot to mention something. One thing I want to highlight here is that with regards to the transcript or the school reports or the teacher letters of rec or anything like that, one thing that's kind of important is that we really do not start working on counselors, the teachers, anybody. We don't really start working on these things until after Labor Day, and we don't submit transcripts. So a lot of students may have already requested their transcript to be sent to a college, but that's not something we would have done yet. And there's a reason for that. We really have to wait for all the parts of last year's grading processes, summer school grades, schedule changes, dual enrollment stuff. All of these things that we work on behind the scenes have to get done in order to have an accurate transcript, have an accurate way of portraying you in a rec letter or a school report or those kinds of things. So, you know, kids are taking online classes, kids are doing dual enrollment stuff, all of this stuff. Everything has to be completely accurate in order for us to then upload all the transcripts and have access to all of them. We don't do them one at a time. So there's lots of behind the scenes things going on, and everything has to be correct before we can begin sending stuff out. So just know that it will begin happening, but it definitely has to wait on certain things to kind of come together before we're ready to do that, because you know, you want it to be accurate. And we've also had new seniors join us this year, and you know, we have to enter their information. They have to be part of the full picture, so gotta make sure all of that is done. Okay, so going back to this, student chooses their application option from the institution. If you go on the college website, you say, I really want to apply to Morehouse College, and I really want to go there. That's fantastic. Morehouse, if you go on there, they are members of the Common Application. So you would click that you're going to maybe apply through there, you're going to submit your application through there, and you're going to pay through there. You have to make sure to complete any supplemental documentation that they might need for your application in order for them to have your portion of the application done. The other options might be coalition or the institutional app. Trying to think, like Kennesaw State University, they use their own application. Georgia Southern, Valdosta, West Georgia, all of them have their own application on their college website. And then you have another application process called the HBCU, the Common Black Common App. And basically that's all the historically Black colleges and universities. There are probably over 50 colleges that utilize this application, and it's a flat fee of $20 to apply to all of them. So some students that may be looking specifically at like a Clark Atlanta or a Fort Valley State or a Grambling or something like that, Tuskegee, they're all going to be part of that. It might make sense to use that application instead of the institutional app. So you really need to look over, I strongly suggest listing out all of the colleges that you are looking to apply to, look at how they accept applications, and then pick the applications that make the most sense. So if you're applying to certain schools, like a UGA and a Georgia State and an Auburn, all of those use Common App. So it doesn't make sense to use their individual applications because you're going to do double the work. Or if you're applying to Kennesaw or Georgia Southern, and those are the only two schools you're applying to, then it doesn't make sense to do Common Application. It makes sense to utilize the institutional app. So you really want to look over some of those decisions before you get started. And I'll talk a little bit more about coalition in a minute. The next thing that you have to do is your transcript. You make your request through Naviance. There's the counselor letter of rec. You do have to complete the senior profile assignment in Teams at least 10 days in advance if you are expecting a letter of recommendation from your counselor. Only needed if a counselor letter is required. We're gonna, you know, we love to support students and all that, but we wanna make sure that we're utilizing every bit of just, you know, doing what's best for students in the long run. And if that college does not require it, they probably do not want it. So just know that. The teacher recommendation, however, schools love to hear from your teachers, your academic core teachers. You can make those requests through Naviance. They like to hear from teachers because they've had you in the classroom for, you know, a period of time, and they know what you bring to a classroom, what you bring to your personality traits, like all of those things that add to your application add value. And then test scores, of course, you're welcome to make those requests through College Board or ACT to make sure that your test scores are sent on time. College deadlines. There are, is the requirement, I should say, there's the requirement to request things at least 10 school days in advance. We've provided the dates right here. School counselors, you know, don't work on weekends. I'm not going to spend my winter break working on applications. I did that early on in my career, and it drains you. So, you know, it's important for self-care and to take time for family, and we're encouraged to do that. And so please plan ahead. So if you know that you are applying to UGA's regular admission and the deadline's January 1st, you need to make sure that you've made all your requests no later than December 4th. That gives us plenty of time to do everything very thoroughly and make sure we're not missing anything for that deadline. Okay, so things to note. It's really not efficient to use Common App or Coalition if your student is only applying to one college, unless the college only uses that source. So please make sure that you're looking over your list of colleges and evaluating which the best tool is. I will say that Naviance is partnered with Common App. Naviance is a new portal that Fulton County is using, and Coalition is not a partner in that. Not to say we cannot submit the documents, we can. It's just it's not a selected option when in the drop-down menu. So It would just be applying direct to the institution is basically how the documents would go. And that is fine, but just know that you want to check out all your options. Not all colleges utilize letters of recommendation. We're only going to submit a letter if the college requires it. And some colleges only want a school report. So the school report just gives an overview of the student. Letters of recommendation are only submitted directly to the institution or the scholarship organization. Counselors do not manage teacher recommendations. So the student does have to request it through Naviance, and then the teacher will complete them through their Naviance portal. So that is all new this year. Teachers too are having to get used to a new way of doing things. It does organize things very well for the teacher end. And at the end of the year, seniors do complete a final checkout form with the counseling office to tell us where to send a final transcript or complete the exit survey that's required by the county. So know that at the end of the year, you are going to come back and tell us, this is my plan. I'm going to go into the military. I plan to take a gap year. I plan to go to this college. You're kind of giving us your rundown at the very end of the year. Okay, so using Naviance for college applications. Naviance is really just a vehicle to get application materials to the college. It accurately tracks college applications, sends your documents, sends your letters of rec, sends your transcripts, and the ability for you to check the status of those materials. So I'm going to kind of go through some of the things about Naviance that are really cool. But one thing to note is that Naviance is not how you apply to the college. This is just the way you're telling us of what you need. So you're telling us that you need a transcript sent. You're telling us that you need a school report or a letter of rec or whatever. You're not applying to the college through Naviance. That is, when you apply to the college, you're applying through the institutional application on the college website, or you're applying through Coalition, or you're applying to through Common App, or you're applying through that HBCU portal. So there's ways to do things, but Naviance is not where you apply. It's the how things get to their destination. One of the first things about Naviance, if you are applying to any Common App school, you have to match your account. I cannot stress this enough. If you don't match your account, match your Common App account to your Naviance portal, as your first step, then it's not going to set things up right. So please make sure that you have done that matching process. There is a video I'm not going to show you where to find the video. It's very helpful. And after you match your Common App account to Naviance, you should not be inviting any recommenders until after you have matched your account. So, you know, that's one of those things that you want to make sure you've done that step. I do realize that not everybody is going to use Common App, but so many schools have joined Common App that it may be something that you're going to plan to do. For example, Georgia State University, their downtown campus, they only use Common App. UGA is on Common App as of this year. Auburn has joined Common App. University of Tennessee is on Common App. So, I mean, there's so many schools, I can't even go through them all. Georgia College and State University, they're on Common App. So it's important for you to research your schools, but if you do end up applying through this method of Common App, you do have to match your account because it just won't line up nicely. Okay, so what it looks like is that you're gonna go to the colleges I'm applying to list in order to match your account. I can't demo this because you literally have to go to your Common App account and you have to set it up properly and then go into Naviance and match your account with a little pink button. And you'll see the pink button on my demo screen in a second, but it is important that you watch the video to learn how to match your account and how to sign your FERPA release waiver. If you haven't done that process, it won't match them properly. Once you have done the matching process, schools from your Common App will feed into your colleges I'm applying to list in Naviance. So they basically take the information from Common App and it automatically feeds into Naviance. So everything is listed for us. So it makes it really easy. But one thing I did find out is that it doesn't work the opposite way. You cannot put colleges into Naviance and then feed them into Common App. It's only you can use Common App to feed into Naviance. It's a kind of a one-way deal. Oh, I didn't know it was going to look like this. Okay, so basically one of the things that you have to do is when you made your Common App account, you had an original email address that you used for Common App. It did not need to be your school email address. It can be whichever one you wanted it to be, but you have to use that when you're matching. You confirm your date of birth and then you select match accounts. Okay. So now, in order to get into Naviance, you're basically going to go into ClassLink. And you should know how to get into ClassLink, but this is where I'm going to exit out of this screen, and then I'm going to pull up Naviance so we can go through it together. I really love, hold on, there it goes. So you should see a Naviance account in front of me. I'm very thankful to a student who's allowing me to use her account for tonight so that I can show you all this stuff. But basically you have this 12th grade welcome. We're allowed to switch out the messages throughout the year. So if you click on the read more, there's a lot of information here. But one of the things is the matching video, actual video on how to request transcripts, an actual video on the letters of rec, and all of this stuff, but I'm going to demo it for you so that you can see it. I need you to know that we're going to review the home screen. We're going to talk about how to add colleges to your list. We're going to talk about how to send transcripts and kind of the bulk of everything we need to talk about. Okay, so this is the home screen. There's a lot of information here. But the big thing is that there's a welcome message at the top. In the top right corner, you're going to see some drop-down menus. And the one that we're going to explore most tonight is this colleges drop-down right here in the top right. We are going to go through the part where it says home. We're going to start there. There are some really cool things. If you're unsure about what college you want to go to or what you want to do, there's a super match where you can put in criteria about yourself and filter some things, and it will help you match what institutions might be a good fit for you based on what you entered. Another thing is there's a college match thing, an advanced college search. There's ways to research colleges, do a compare between colleges. This is way more features than we've ever had. Naviance is a fantastic program at providing information and searchability for this kind of thing. The things that we're going to do is this apply to colleges right here, but it's also up here in the top right. Again, under colleges, drop down, go to colleges I'm applying to, and that's where we're going to start. I went into the account and I added some schools just so y'all could see initially what it looks like, but just so you know, it will say, you know, for example, over here, the college, Georgia State University, it says the submission type. It says the transcripts have been requested, but that they're pending, that they haven't been sent. It gives you the deadlines. It tells you all of this information. We're going to add a school because I want you to see something. So I'm going to add, and I just press that little pink button over there in the right corner, and I'm going to say, what college am I applying to? We're going to apply to the Savannah College of Art and Design. And it tells you right here what the application submissions look like. And we're just going to do the rolling admission. It will only give you the application type that applies to the college. And I'm going to say, I'm really not sure when I'm going to submit my application. I'm not positive, but I'm going to add that application because I want my school counselor to know that I'm adding it. It is now on the list, okay? But as you can see, it has a question mark over here for submission type. That tells your school counselor that you haven't made a decision on how, you know, whether or not you've submitted the application. Okay, so that's important to your school counselor because you've got to go back in and fix that. Requesting transcripts. Let me get to my page here. So when we did that, we checked off how we were going to submit the application and whether or not it was a rolling application or whether or not we did not request the transcripts, but we probably need to. If we need to request transcripts and we didn't do it initially, we can come up here to request transcripts and click on this plus button. And we're going to say we want the initial type of transcript sent and our preference to send it to. Where are we sending these transcripts? Well, we needed to send them to the Savannah College of Art and Design. Done. Request and finish. That button at the bottom, that is where you're going to want to click. Now it has rolled from, saying that not requested, it hadn't been requested, to now it's pending. When it has been sent, it will be, it will say submitted. So know that there is a way to do it. Okay, there is a way to add a transcript after you've added the college. Probably the easier way to do it is when you add the college initially, you go ahead and request them if you know that they're going to be sent. Okay, let's talk about letters of recommendation. So right here, when you scroll down, so you're on the main screen of going back to colleges, there's a couple ways to get to it, but you're going to say colleges, apply to college, and then things come up here. Letters of recommendation, manager transcripts, test scores. Fulton County does not have the option for you to send test scores, so that's kind of a little tab that really doesn't have a lot of meaning. But right here for letters of recommendation, if you click on that, it's going to take you to a page where you're allowed to request your letter of recommendation. This is how your teachers will be, told that they have a recommendation request waiting for them. This is very important. If you do not do it through Naviance, it will not happen. So you would go up here to the top right again, where it says add request, and you're clicking here. Now this is, I think, one of the most important screens in Naviance for the college application process because you're requesting a letter to go to a college. So right here, it tells me that two are allowed for Savannah College of Art and Design. Fantastic. I want Miss Jones to be the one to submit it, Donna Jones. She is the art teacher here. She teaches a lot of the AP classes. Great, I want her to submit my recommendation. If I say I want all and future colleges right here for Miss Jones to write my letter, then when I click that and I include in my request, thank you for writing my letter for SCAD, and I submit the request, then she, if she writes that letter, it goes to all the colleges on the list. So if I've also applied to, for example, MIT, or UGA, or Vanderbilt, or Brown, or any of those schools where maybe you want your science teacher to submit your recommendation, or your math teacher to submit your recommendation, or whatever. Miss Jones is the one that you selected that's gonna go for all the recommendations. So that's the one that's gonna go to MIT, that's the one that's gonna go. So it is better to choose specific colleges. You're going to want Miss Jones only to do Savannah College of Art and Design, and you're going to write her a little note. Thank you for writing this letter for me. I will email you my resume. I think you are awesome. Great. Submit request, and it has gone to Miss Jones as a recommender. Now, I can still cancel this request as long as she hasn't done anything. But if she has submitted the recommendation, you cannot then cancel the request. It's too late. Okay? It says, way to go, Donna Jones is going to be notified of this recommendation request. So my advice to you is that when you add a request, you do choose a specific college that you want, you know, Miss Ames, the AP Chem teacher, to write it for UGA. You're checking off who you want your recommendations to be selected for, and you're writing a little note to them, and then they're getting that. That is the best way I can tell you to do your letters of recommendation for teachers, okay? You can also track your letters of recommendation and track the status of them. So we're gonna go back to colleges I'm applying to, apply to college, letters of recommendation. And now we see that it's been requested to Ms. Jones, and the status is it's just been requested. When it rolls over and it has been submitted, it will say submitted. You can see the status change over here when it gets submitted. The same process goes for transcript requests. Go back to colleges, apply to college, manage transcripts, and you can see all of the processes that everything is pending because we have not sent anything out yet. We, again, don't send anything out until a little bit later. Trying to think if there's anything else. You can also request later for a mid-year report if you have to have one for the college, or a final report to be sent at the end of the year, of course. But the mid-year, know that we do not release transcripts for mid-year reports until at least January 15th, because we have to get all the grades, everything has to be finalized, dual enrollment grades, all that stuff has to be on the transcripts before we can send mid-years. Another great feature of Naviance is a scholarship search. So down here, again, colleges tab, all the way down, scholarships and money. There's a matching service, a scholarship list, a national scholarship search. This is a great portal for beginning to look through scholarships. Hopefully, this has been able to give you a good overview of how to apply for colleges. You know, say we wanted to add one more and we're going to apply to, I don't know, let's say we want to apply to Brown. I wonder if it's in here. Oh, they might. Well, I would think they would be. Brown. There's a lot. I probably picked a wrong one, guys. Or I've looked it up wrong. Clearly, I didn't think this one through. You know, I'm just alone in my office talking to myself, so. Oh, Brown University, there we go. So Brown University, and we're looking early decision, or we're gonna do regular decision. Those are your two options. If we do early decision, that's a binding agreement. That is not early action. So I don't wanna do early decision. I'm not 100% sure that I'm gonna commit there. I would like to do regular decision. And I'm going to submit it either direct to the institution or via Common App. I'm going to do direct to the institution. And I'm going to add and go ahead and request my transcript. I'm going to do an initial transcript. I'm sending it to Brown and request and finish. Again, it's going to show up here. It's saying my deadline was January 2nd. And where are my office materials? They're pending. And the transcripts are requested. So over here under submission type, oh, this was a good one. The line through basically means that they offer Common App, but we're choosing not to use Common App. We're gonna do in a direct to institution. That's what that means to your counselor, okay? So there's lots of very cool tools in here. I hope that you'll explore this a little bit further on your own. Okay, let's head back to the PowerPoint. We just have a few more slides, and then we're gonna wrap up. Oh, geez, I didn't want to do that. Let's go down here to where we were. Yes, it's a lot of slides. But we're right here, closing thoughts on college applications from current slide. And basically, you should be working on your college applications now if you plan to go to college after high school. The Common App essay prompts are available. You should send your application when you've completed all the parts. You should not wait on school documents. Everything will follow your application materials. So get your application and everything submitted, and then the school part will follow. If you're an athlete, again, you need to touch base with Ms. Lang. You should be checking your email regularly. You should be touching base with your counselor if you have questions. The counselors are utilizing Teams for a lot of announcements. Please go on there and look. And then always, always, always check your status page with the college. The status page with the college is completely different than the Naviance status page. So the status page in Naviance is telling you what the high school has done. The college status page, when you log into UGA, there's a status check, is telling you where you stand with their process. So please make sure that you're following up with the college. Okay, there's the Hooch Apply to College Day. We're going to do our 7th annual Hooch Apply to College Day. If you need help with an application, if you have questions about Naviance, if you have questions about submitting anything, really any questions about the whole process, we are available 8:30 to 3, and you would use the code on this screen. You can take a picture right here of that code, and that's the code to enter the Apply to College team. So we're going to have a team for that, and then I encourage you to come during your lunch period or your chat time or a free period for assistance. If you have to miss a class, you really need to get permission before doing so. Senior class council. These are our awesome students who are leading the senior class. They're brilliant minds out there, and I just love seeing their fun faces. But they are brainstorming ideas on what would make this year awesome and for you to get your best experience. So they are offering up, if you want to join, you can scan the QR code, you can fill out the form on there. If you were part of the class council last year, you've been added already. You can follow on Instagram, you can email them at Gmail, but they are fantastic students stepping up in this crazy pandemic year to make sure that you have a good experience. So please help them out with ideas and join. The Hooch Yearbook. The Hooch Yearbook is a student-run publication, and you can reach them on hoochyearbook.com. The reason why I wanted to present this is because they are, if you haven't scheduled your senior portraits, if you need to reserve a recognition senior ad, you want to pre-order your yearbook, which is the lowest price of the year, is this time of year. It only goes up from here. And they want to tell your story, so they have a 3-question survey. Again, I encourage all students to, you know, buy a yearbook, get your senior portraits done, get your recognition ad ahead of time so that they're not scrambling at the end. Also, the PTSA, we have such a great PTSA. We are so thrilled with everything they do for us, but they also, for seniors, they do a senior treats, and all those plans are underway. There are dues of $50 that fund 100% of their budget. And so that is your senior treats. That's your graduation yard sign. And you know, in May, those yard signs were like our last bit of hope. Gold envelopes. Each senior receives their own gold envelope containing all the well wishes from family and friends. And then every year they do a senior scholarship, but it's only open to those who joined for and paid their dues. So do so now. You're just going to go to chatcougarptsa.org. You sign up and pay online, and it is an awesome resource. Last little bit here, I'm just reiterating that you can make an appointment. It's a clickable link on the website. You have to go to meet your counseling staff. And then I hope that if you have, you know, questions that I haven't addressed, then you can do that. Ms. Blunt is going to be able to answer your questions. Ms. Blunt, I don't know if you want to pop in or just
come. I am here.
Hi.
Close my door. Hi.
We're all in our own offices.
Huh?
I said we're in our own offices.
We are, with the doors closed, so there's no feedback. Okay, so I've been answering a lot of questions, so many questions. Seriously, there's 51 in the private and then 47 that I've published. And some of them are repeats, so I'm trying to, you know, refer them back to previous answers. Okay. There's a couple that I don't really know the answers to so far. And since you know Naviance from, you know, putting this presentation together, a student says, how do you know that you have successfully matched Common App to Naviance? Okay, is there an indicator at the top?
Yeah, that pink line at the very top. Let me see if I can pull it back up. Hold on. Let me see if it closed me out here. I've been having such issues. Oh, here it is. This pink line. Oh, you can't see it. Let me send it live. This pink line at the very top, when you click match accounts after you have done your portion, that will go away. It totally doesn't ask you to match your account again. That's how you know you did it right.
Okay, perfect. Another student says, my Common App is linked to Naviance, but my Common App colleges are not feeding into Naviance. How do I fix this?
My guess is that you did not use the same email address, perhaps, of when you opened your Common App account to when you tried to match your account. You have to use the exact same email address that you opened your Common App account with. That's my only guess. If that student continues to have problems, then we'll just need to do like a get together, like a little appointment to see what's going on. We can share our screens and figure it out.
Okay. I'm just going to read through some that have been typed
in. And just one, I will say, we are all learning Naviance as we go. Yes. We are building the plane as we fly it, as they say. So
absolutely.
In this together, we all are going to need a lot of patience and grace as we make it through this process.
Yes. Okay, cool. So I'm going to talk through a couple of the questions that have come through. I feel like that just might be faster than me typing away.
Yes.
Student says, do we send our transcripts after getting accepted by a college or before to the college we're applying to? So your transcript is going to be a very, very key piece as to your application. Your application has to include a transcript. I don't know a single college you can apply to and not send a transcript. So you will not be accepted until you send a transcript.
Yeah, some colleges may accept a self-reported unofficial copy, but they're still gonna wanna see it. Whether it's through you or through us. So I think it's better just to go ahead and request it and have it sent.
Yeah. Even the schools, like Ms. Chilson said, even the schools where you self-report your grades and your classes, if you get accepted there, every single one of those schools will want a final transcript, of course, confirming those were the correct ones that you entered, that type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Transcripts, important. I think it's a parent says the academic history in Infinite Campus seems wiped out. Where can parents review the historic results from past school years?
I would say all of that should be in Infinite Campus under documents. You should be able to access your child's transcript through Infinite Campus under the documents tab.
Okay, so you having children in Fulton County, that probably is good for you to answer because you've probably seen that. Yeah,
I can see my kids' report cards. My kids don't have our transcript yet.
Yeah,
they're still little, but thank God.
Yeah.
But I do think that you should be able to see it. Now, if you can't, I would just say let's touch base and send an email to your counselor if that's the case so that we can get it worked out from the student information side, because if it's happening to a lot of people, then it's probably countywide.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, this seems like a duplicate question. I linked my Naviance account properly and added my colleges to Common App, but they're not showing up on colleges I'm applying to. Should I manually add them, or this is an error? So that might be the same thing that you said earlier, Ms. Chilson. They might have used a different email address.
Yeah, it's possible.
Yeah.
Because if it's not done exactly right, it won't link properly. Now, you cannot add colleges in your list and expect them to go over to Common App. It doesn't work that way. They have to start in Common App and then get linked.
Yeah. Okay. And like Ms. Chilson said, you know, we're building this plane as we fly. So if you can't figure out some, you know, whatever's going on with that, you know, you can always reach out, you know, if there's like a help desk or, you know, a help option within Naviance. If that doesn't work out, then, you know, either I, you know, that's my student or your counselor, I'm sure would be happy to schedule a video conference. So, you know, we can help you work through that. And actually with a video conference, you can share your screen so we can actually see where you're clicking, that kind of stuff.
I think it's important to be able to share the screen.
Yeah.
So that we can know what it looks like, because even for me, I don't have a Common App account that's a student looking one. So anytime there's an issue, it's not going to necessarily come up right. There's a couple of things in the profile portion of Common App that if you didn't check it off correctly, it may not sync right. And one of those is like our, you know, putting in the correct high school. I know that sometimes students get us confused, unfortunately, with Chattahoochee County High School. And so that, you know, we have to go back and look at a couple of things to see if there's an issue.
Yeah. Okay. Student wants to know, what is the procedure with National Merit Scholarship this year? So we have not even received what we need to receive from National Merit to then start our process. So it'll be the same as we have done ever, you know, in the past years. I'm actually the coordinator for National Merit. So once we get that information, you know, we'll get the list of students and their login information, and then we will be in contact with those students as soon as we get that information and tell y'all kind of our timeline of when we need stuff turned back in on their portal.
Yeah.
Okay. Student wants to know if I plan on transferring to my dream college after 2 years, do I apply now or do I apply later? So if you apply later, you apply to the colleges you're going to go to now, because typically an admissions decision is only good for, you know, a certain term or a certain year. Mm-hmm. So you don't, you know, if you are pretty sure you're going to be transferring schools, you apply to the quote dream college later on after you've, you know, done your first year or two of college, and then you're applying as a transfer student.
And I love that option. I mean, especially, you know, to start off somewhere else and maybe a cheaper option.
Uh-huh.
And then especially with COVID going on and all this stuff, we don't know what it's going to look like for next fall. So, you know, if you wanted to start off somewhere around town and then transfer into that dream school later, that is a great option.
Yeah. Okay. Is there an advantage to apply with early decision if you know where you would like to go? So actually, I was just reading something online about that, that if you're absolutely positively sure you want to go to a certain school, I have read that certain, you know, schools' early decision acceptance rates are typically a little bit higher than their regular decision, you know, acceptance rates. So you do kind of fall into that advantage category.
I would only do early decision if they offer you, you are saying I'm going. So you really need to be certain, because I've had students in the past that have changed their mind at the last minute. And the problem with that is that you made a commitment on the onset, changed your mind. And it kind of, I heard in one admissions group that they don't always, but if it happens a lot at Chattahoochee kind of gets dinged for it. So, you know, because it's like your word isn't any good. Mm-hmm. So just know that it should be a serious commitment.
I have also read places that, you know, certain schools, you know, I think there's a group of like 30 universities, and it might be something like the Ivy Leagues or like the more kind of elite, quote, elite privates, that they actually will share with each other list of students who have applied and been admitted for early decision. So if schools find out that a student has applied to two different schools early decision, that student has basically violated the terms of the agreement they signed for both schools, and that student could lose their chance of admissions to both schools.
Correct.
So that's not a gamble you want to take.
Yeah.
Some colleges like Alabama require every college eventually is going to require an official transcript.
Correct.
So you submit. So for University of Alabama, you do their own application on their website, and then you go on Naviance, you log in through ClassLink, request a transcript. That's it. So
Naviance is really your portal for telling us what your plan is. So last year, previous years, the school counselors have used Google Classroom for students to tell us information. This year, we're switching to Naviance and using that portal for information sharing.
Yeah. So the student, I think, is also a little bit confused about official transcripts versus initial transcript. They're the same. Every single transcript we send is always going to be official. Mm-hmm. Initial, that's just our term for this is the first time you've requested a transcript for a certain school. Mm-hmm. Then the mid-year transcript is that would be one that we send out after the beginning of January once your first semester grades are posted on it.
Correct. And a good example of that is like you applied early action to UGA. They have an October 15th deadline, mm-hmm. and then you got deferred and need to submit additional documentation. So maybe you want to send your updated transcript in January. So we would have sent the initial, and now we're sending another updated copy in January.
Yeah. If we have already matched, if we have already matched Naviance with Common App, do we still add the colleges in Naviance? So you only add colleges in Common App if you are using Common App with Naviance. So you don't add them in Naviance. They don't go backwards.
But also, say you do Common App and you've added your colleges there and they're now in Naviance. That's great. But then you decide you also want to apply to Kennesaw. Well, Kennesaw is not on Common App. You would add that one in just into Naviance. You're not adding that into Common App. They don't exist on Common App.
Yeah. So that answer is a yes and a no.
Yeah.
What is the reason to do direct application and not go through Common App? It's all personal preference. And you know, if a student is applying to say UGA and Georgia Tech and Georgia State, then every single one of those goes through Common App. A couple of them, I think Georgia State does not exist on Coalition. I think UGA exists on Coalition. Common App is really just a fabulous system. So if you can do every single one of your applications on Common App, do it. It's great for you. It's great for us. It is very seamless.
It's seamless. It's so easy to use for y'all and for us.
So really the only reason I would think a student would do a direct application and not go through Common App is if school is not on Common App. That would be it. So like Kennesaw, Ms. Chilson just mentioned, they're not on Common App, so you do a direct application at Kennesaw. Mm-hmm. How do you update incorrect personal info on Naviance?
Oh.
I would think there'd be a profile edit place or something like that, or I'm wondering if, because the accounts were linked to Chattahoochee, basically Fulton County information, that's something that maybe we can help work through for you. If you have that question, then reach out to your individual counselor. We'll help you work through that. My question is, if we have previously requested transcripts on Naviance before we're sending them, should we request again to remind the counselor? No, you do not have to request again. That request is still sitting there. We were just waiting to process them until after this meeting. If I've already requested a teacher for a letter of recommendation under all colleges option, can I change it to a specific college after they've submitted it?
No.
And that they also want to know, are there any advantages of having the letter be for a specific college or not? So you would only say specific college if, actually you wouldn't, because.
The reason why you want to say specific college is because say you say it for all of them, you want a certain teacher to write. Well, then, you don't want, the example I gave was like Ms. Jones, it's fine for SCAD for her, but she's not an academic teacher. So if you're applying to UGA or Yale or Brown or even Georgia State, I mean, they want to hear from an academic teacher. So if she submitted it and it went to all of them, that was your, and only one was allowed, that's your one. Yeah. That's it.
Mm-hmm. What should the timetable be for teacher recommendations? So we want students to do the same timetable as for teachers as they do for us. So at least, if not more, 10 school days and you got to keep in mind weekends and holidays and Thanksgiving break and winter break, you know. Mm-hmm.
Teachers, we love you guys. We will do anything for you, but it, with so many kids applying to really a lot of competitive schools, it's a lot of time to do all of these little things, and we like to do it. We want to do it, but we want to do it in a timely manner. And I will say, like Alpharetta High School, they require 3 weeks.
Wow. Okay.
So, you know.
Think of us like your doctor's office. You're not going to email your doctor's office on a Thursday night asking for something for Friday morning, because it's not going to happen. Of course, they want to help you just like we do. But also think of it like we're not going to email you at night or on the weekend and say, hey, Johnny, I need this from you ASAP, or I need this from you on Monday morning. So, you know, we are respectful of your time, you know, your time in general, your time with your families, your time on the weekends. We want the same to be, you know, done for us and teachers. So we say at least 10 school days. And so you definitely just got to kind of keep that in mind. And I've actually seen some teachers, you know, if we're looking at 8 or 9 days ahead of time, or maybe even less, they will say no, because that you have not given them enough time to do what they need to do to get you to write you a really good letter.
Definitely last year I saw a teacher put on their door,
mm-hmm.
I am at my max limit on rec letters. I mm-hmm. cannot write another one. You're mm-hmm. going to have to find somebody else, because mm-hmm. it was just, they'd already been asked so many times.
Yeah.
So please make sure you know, plan ahead.
Yeah, of course. When we request for letters of recommendation, do we have to send the teachers our resume? That might be an individual teacher thing. Usually teachers are going to be writing about how you were as a student in their class, how engaged you were, you know, if you were asking questions, if you were inquisitive, you know, all that kind of stuff. So they might not necessarily need a resume. You can always ask them if they would like a copy of it, and you can send it to them if you have a resume already created. Someone asked if these questions will be available to read again on demand for reference. Probably not, but if you have any questions, reach out to us, please. The FERPA waiver, that is on Common App, correct, Ms. Tilson?
Okay. Correct. That's a portion, like after you complete the Common App profile about your education and who you are, you know, just all these questions about your profile, then you're going to go to add to your dashboard a college. Every college requires a FERPA waiver. You have to complete the FERPA waiver in order for then it to get added to Naviance.
Yeah.
If you are seeing in Common App a place to put teacher recommendations in, you did not complete something in the profile correctly. The profile specifically states if you're a Naviance school, it all goes through Naviance. So you shouldn't even have the option to put a teacher recommender in Common App.
Yeah. Okay, so let's see. If you are an international student, are there any resources to gain information for college applications, more so if we've lived here for a few years but want to avoid out-of-state tuition? I would recommend you reach out to your school counselor so we can kind of help guide you in the right direction for that. That's a pretty specific student question. If you're doing dual enrollment at Georgia State, do you have to reapply to be a full-time student? Yes. So technically you're a student at Perimeter College within Georgia State. If you want to attend the Atlanta campus of Georgia State for college next school year, you do have to do their application on Common App. Now, if you're doing dual enrollment at Perimeter and you want to go to Perimeter College for college next school year, then you do not actually have to do Common App. Perimeter College, which is the two-year program at Georgia State, you would only have to do a reactivation application.
Mm-hmm.
What do we do if our college of choice requires a test score, but you can't take an SAT or ACT and can't get an AP score? So that's, I think, a time when we have to think of a backup option for the time being. It might just be that your dream college we end up transferring to later on after you've earned some college credit. It could also be that, I mean, just was it last week that the state of Georgia decided to, or Georgia Student Finance Commission decided, sorry, Board of Regents decided to waive SAT and ACT scores for public colleges in Georgia. So it could be that that college makes a decision to waive test scores tomorrow or the next week or, you know, later in September, who knows. In Common App, it says you're in a practice account. That looks like you maybe have created your account incorrectly. You might have to create another account, or you might want to. Common App is really good about, they have a really quick working help desk situation. So you can submit a help desk ticket and they'll get back to you within usually just a couple of hours, of course, during business hours. How do rec letters for scholarship applications work? So that won't be through Naviance. Scholarship application rec letters will, you know, if you need a counselor rec, that would just be you contacting us and letting us know what you need. And if a recommendation letter is needed for my teacher for a scholarship application, that's the same. You would just contact that teacher about that.
It does need to go directly to the organization. It's not something where a counselor would give the recommendation letter to the student directly.
Yeah, we never provide, and that is not saying anything about you as a student. That's, you should actually feel good. You know, if we or a teacher, anyone is saying, yes, I'm going to write you a recommendation letter, that's us saying we can speak very highly of you as a student. So, but because of just, you know, privacy and other different, you know, considerations that the organizations and scholarships, you know, they want to be sure that that letter is 100% authentic from us. So that's why, you know, they only want it directly from us. Student wants to know, is AP Psych not counted towards a graduation requirement? So while AP Psych does not satisfy a specific graduation requirement like World History or US History, it's still an academic subject and it counts as an elective. School I want to go to has an admission deadline of January 4th. Will first semester grades be available by then? Most likely not. First semester grades usually aren't posted by Fulton County until, I don't know, January 10th or 12th. Usually those schools, though, you'll go ahead and submit an initial transcript. So that would just be showing grades through the end of junior year. And then you can always request an updated transcript be sent once your fall semester grades are posted. Do schools not have any essays often at all? There are plenty of colleges that do not care for an essay, do not care for a recommendation letter. They want to see, in a non-COVID situation, your test scores. Every school, of course, is going to, you know, want to see your GPA, and that's possible. There are plenty of schools out there that want you to apply, submit the application fee, your GPA, and of course, non-COVID test scores, and then you're in. So don't, you know, if you're applying to, you know, Kennesaw and North Georgia and Valdosta and Georgia Southern, it's possible you might not have to write an essay, and that's no problem at all. How can I calculate my GPA for the coming semester for Hope or Zell Miller? So you can always see your Hope or Zell Miller progress GPA on your Georgia Futures profile. Of course, you won't be able to actually know your GPA for this semester until your grades are posted, but you can see, you know, the GPA that you have on your progress report for Hope and Zell Miller. And then you can, you know, do the math and figure out what grades you might need to get this semester to earn either of those scholarships. If you have, you know, trouble doing that, reach out to your school counselor. I'm sure we can help you, guide you in the right direction. Just know that we are not the final say. Georgia Student Finance Commission is the only, you know, institution that has the final say on, yes, this is actually your GPA. Someone wants to know, ACT or ACT are mandatory for this year, 2021. Not necessarily. No, there are plenty of schools that are waiving SAT and ACT requirements because of COVID. When a college has an application deadline, is that just for the application or do they expect scores, transcripts, letters of recommendation by this date as well? Generally, if a college has a deadline, it's for everything. Sometimes colleges will say, this is a deadline for XYZ materials, and then ABC materials can come by, you know, a week or two later. An anonymous student says, do I still have time to catch up to graduate? I would recommend you reach out to your individual counselor. I'm sure we can come up with a plan to make that happen. How can a parent access ClassLink and Naviance? Parents do not have access to ClassLink and Naviance. If parents wants to see what's happening in ClassLink and Naviance, then you would actually need to get your student to sit down and log into ClassLink and then to Naviance, and then y'all can sit together and do some research. Will colleges be able to email students with their school email account? So I'm guessing, I'm honestly not positive. I think it would probably be good for, you know, of course, plenty of Fulton County students use their Fulton County student email address to communicate, but that email address will not be available to you once you graduate. So eventually you're going to need your own personal email account. So it couldn't hurt for you to just go ahead and create, you know, a Gmail account or whatever. Please make it an appropriate email account. I've seen some that are somewhat questionable, and I'm not even going to mention things on here because they're not appropriate, but just, you know, think of the adult world. Colleges want to be able to communicate with someone that has an appropriate email address. So that's all I'm going to say about that. Common App, where can I get the Common App? It's commonapp.org. If we did dual enrollment classes, do we have to submit transcripts from each individual DE college as well as the high school transcript? So typically, yes, your future colleges do want to see transcripts from any colleges you attended through dual enrollment. It is a similar process, but transcripts from dual enrollment colleges, you have to request those through their system. Transcripts for dual enrollment colleges do not go through Naviance. Okay, I already answered that one. Are we able to get our counselors for help with our resume? I mean, I'm sure, you know, we're happy to give you a couple tips here and there. Generally with a resume, you know, what would be good to share would be, you know, volunteer experience. If you have any work experience, you know, part-time, summer jobs, whatever.
There's some great templates out there. I mean, you can Google resume, student resume, and there are some fantastic templates that already exist.
Yes. With Naviance, we use the student ID number from ClassLink. While in Common App, I use my email address as a parent. Not sure my colleges have been matched through. So parent email addresses should not be used when applying to college. It should only be student email addresses.
We have had some situations where parents accidentally submitted stuff to the school, and then it just messed up their whole application process.
Or were incorrect.
Yeah.
Where we find, okay, we already covered that. Naviance is automatically linked with our school email. I don't know if Naviance is automatically linked with your school email. Someone is asking, Ms. Chilson, you might be able to help this. If our Naviance is automatically linked with our school email, we won't be able to properly link our Common App because we
No, you can. Email. You can use it. It's whatever email you used on Common App. That doesn't have anything to do with getting into Naviance. You can get into Naviance through ClassLink, and you have already done the Common App process for your profile and adding colleges to your dashboard in Common App. And then you go into Naviance, you log in as normal, but when you're matching your account, it's going to ask you what Common App email did you use? And that's what it's going to connect it.
Perfect. Okay, parent asks, I need my son's GPA to include first semester in the admission GPA. Should I fill everything up and wait for after first semester to request transcript? So if and this is for anyone, so if you want a college to consider your first semester grades, your first semester classes, when they are looking at you for admission, you should wait and apply at the beginning of second semester and then request your transcript after your first semester grades and classes have posted. Someone asks about merit-based scholarships. So merit-based scholarships are generally going to be, you know, based on a student's GPA or test scores, if applicable. It could be, you know, certain classes that they've taken, that kind of stuff. I already answered the question about the timetable for teacher recs, but someone also asked, when should we email our teacher to remind them? So this would be, you know, you give them at least 10 days ahead of time before the application deadline. I would not recommend emailing anytime within that 10-day period and saying, hey, where's my rec? Hey, where's my rec? Give them some time to process it. If we're talking 3-4 weeks after you ask them, maybe you send them a quick email and say, hey, just checking. Thank you so much for helping me out. Or if we're back in the building.
And honestly, a college is not going to penalize the student if a part of the supplemental materials, like a rec letter, is late. That's never happened. We've always been assured of that. So even if it was a day late or whatever, it really, I know it may stress you a little bit, but it also depends on how in advance you asked. But I would give the teacher a little grace to get it done, give them the full 10 days and then ask. Or on the last day, the 10th day, you want to ask, then ask.
Okay. There's a lot of questions in here. If we are applying for early action with a deadline of early October, first semester grades will not be on the transcript. It will just be junior year and before.
Right.
If the university you're applying to only uses Coalition, you will still use Naviance to request the transcript. It will just be a direct to institution.
Correct.
For dual enrollment classes, how do we know which colleges accept the credits? So what I always advise students and parents to do is go in Google, type in Florida State University transfer equivalency. And more often than not, it will bring up a table for that specific school, and you'll be able to select, I want to see which credits transfer from a college in. You'll select drop down Georgia, then you might select Georgia State, and it'll show you a massive list probably of all the college classes that they have already evaluated from that school and which ones will be accepted. I know some Florida schools are a little bit less transparent. I feel like I've had plenty of students take dual enrollment credits to Florida schools, no problem. But like when I've looked at, Auburn and Alabama and South Carolina, there's a massive list. But we do, of course, recommend the student and parent do that research to be absolutely certain.
And there's a lot of times that those classes will help you in the admissions process because it shows rigor, but then it may not count towards credit when you get to the college. And that is totally up to the college. But, then I know some people are like, well, then why did I do all this? But, if your goal was to really get into that, competitive school, then, sometimes that's why we do things,
Yeah. Okay, let's see. If I added colleges on Common App and they didn't get added to Naviance, and then I added those colleges on Naviance, is that a problem? That could be a problem. I'm thinking if you added colleges on Common App and they didn't get added to Naviance, then there's probably a problem with your account being linked.
Matched. Yeah.
Yeah. Again, that would be reach out to your school counselor. We'll work through that. Am I supposed to use my school email for Common App? Like I said previously, you're not going to have access to that school email after you graduate. So I would recommend you not use your school email for Common App. If you don't already have one, create your own personal email address. If your test date is after October 15th early admissions, can we still apply early and later turn in our score? That is possible. Plenty of schools will say, oh, we'll take the October whatever deadline, October whatever test date, even though it's an October 15th admissions deadline. Definitely reach out to the individual school to be sure. Can we request teacher recs through Naviance, even for colleges not on Common App like MIT and Georgetown? Yes. Foreign language is an academic class for teacher recs. If you're applying as an art major to an academic school, can you get an art teacher rec still? That would be a question to ask the individual college just to be sure.
And usually they'll say something in their website about what kinds of recommendations for different programs they might be expecting.
Yeah. Do we have to match our Naviance with our Common App in order for the teachers to see their recommendations? So you have to match them so the teacher recs go to the right place.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which GPA will I be judged on in college admission? That's going to be, you're asking for Georgia Tech and Kennesaw. So every single school will take your grades from your high school transcript. If there's any adjustments, adding weight that they might do, and then they will calculate it from there. So Georgia Tech, every public school, and this is a Board of Regents policy, so every four-year public school in Georgia does not remove honors points. They keep your grade on your transcript as is, and then they calculate it from there. All public four-year colleges in Georgia also only use your academic classes, so they're not including your grades from band, orchestra, weight training, health, that kind of stuff. Can we remove colleges after we add them to Naviance, Ms. Chilson?
You can, but it has to go through your counselor. So there's no way for you to delete an application out of Naviance because, like in that training we had the other day, mm-hmm. I was like, I want to be able to delete something out of somebody's, and the remove button does not exist. So the counselor has the access to be able to remove it. But I would want something in writing so that the student then didn't come back to me and say, you deleted this college from from my portal, and I was applying there, and now I missed the deadline. So. Mm-hmm.
If we asked a teacher for a letter of rec during the summer, wow, that's very early. do we have to ask them through Naviance? Yes, you still do, because it still has to have that connection to get to the college.
The teachers have to do the recommendations through Naviance.
Yes. Can I change my email on Naviance to my personal email so it will match up with Common App? So Ms. Chilson answered that. When you do the matching process on Naviance, you will enter the email address that you use for Common App.
Correct.
On the senior profile, under number one, do you want us to put all the colleges we are applying to? Yes, please, all of them. If a student's GPA is listed as 3.12, I'm not exactly sure where you're seeing that. Is that for all classes or just core? In other words, how do we know if that qualified them for HOPE, or if part of that grade point also includes A's in personal fitness and art? So you'll know if you qualify for HOPE if you look at your HOPE progress GPA on Georgia Futures. That is the only place that is absolutely certain that it's calculated. So yes, that is where you need to look for HOPE qualification. FERPA is the Federal Educational Rights to Privacy Act. You sign that agreement on Common App. The option to ask for teacher rec for a non-HOOCH school isn't available. Will I need to email my past teacher directly? I guess you can.
There is a way in Common App for you to add additional people, like an advisor, a coach, a mentor. Those are different than teacher recommendations. So in Common App, it still gives you that option on the recommender page for the college.
Gotcha. Yes. When I transfer to a different school after a couple of years, would I need to give teacher recommendations? Maybe not.
Probably not. Yeah.
Usually when you're applying as a transfer student, it is just your college GPA. If for some reason you're applying to a specific program, it might ask for a college professor recommendation from a similar class or something like that. But typically when you're applying for as a transfer student, they don't want anything from high school, recs, transcripts, nothing.
Yeah.
Okay, we already covered that. What information should I plan to give to scholarships? Everyone is different. That's really all I can say about that. Some want to know your leadership, any leadership roles you've taken on, athletic, there's a whole bunch of stuff. Is there a webinar to go over the application process for HOPE scholarship? So that some of that is going to be covered in the financial aid night. There's pretty specific information on Georgia Futures as well. Okay, there's a whole bunch of questions in here. I'm going to read just a couple more that seem to be pretty common ones. And then if for some reason your question was not answered, you're welcome to email your counselor and just ask. Okay, I've already asked that. Yes. Yep.
I can see we still have about 150 people in the meeting, which is fantastic. Uh-huh. But we have been going now for about 2 hours, so I do want to wrap it up. So any last minute and pressing questions, but then other than that, we do want to answer your questions, but maybe just send an email to your counselor.
Yes. Okay. And a lot of these seem to be pretty common ones about the FERPA and pairing Naviance with Common App. Someone asked, should students send their counselor a copy of their resume? So we covered that a little bit earlier in the presentation. Don't email us a copy of your resume. Every single senior has been invited to their specific counselor's teams. So it's T880, class of 2021, and then your counselor's name. There's an assignment for you to complete on there, and it's basically, it is kind of resume-ish, but there's some questions that we want you to answer to give us a good idea of certain pieces of information so that we can write a really good rec letter for you.
You absolutely have to complete that senior profile in Teams in order to get a counselor recommendation letter completed.
Yes. Couple questions, a couple of people are asking about test scores for Zell Miller and HOPE. So HOPE has no test score requirement. You don't have to worry about that. Zell Miller typically does have a test score requirement. We have not heard any information about Georgia Student Finance Commission changing that. However, that is actually a Georgia law. So a law would have to be changed. And y'all have done political science. Y'all know the process that would be involved in that. So I wouldn't bank on that. I mean, absolute worst case scenario, a student that would qualify for Zell but doesn't have the test scores would still have HOPE. So that still covers a large chunk. HOPE and Zell Miller does not cover out-of-state colleges at all. And I think I'm back to where I was previously. So I think we've answered.